Hello and welcome this afternoon. As you can see, I'm not Christiane Schulzki-Haduti, if you have still read that name in the printed program, but my name is Florian Cramer, and I will moderate the panel this afternoon. Christiane, who conceived this panel and is really an expert on this topic, computing and also its political impacts, couldn't make it today, so I'm replacing her. Speakers today are, right from me, Konrad Becker, known as a media activist since a long time and director of public netbase in Vienna. Then Wendy Chun from Brown University in Providence, USA, cultural studies researcher, media theorist, working on software code and computing and its cultural implications. And then McKenzie Wark, also a media theorist and critic teaching at the New School at New York City. And I think he's well known here in this auditorium for his involvement on various net cultural mailing lists such as NetTime. So my own background is that of arts, literature, and computing, and I'm really only an amateur at politics, but ultimately I think our topic today is political, so to use a German expression, I think I got this topic like a virgin got the baby, and when I read the panel abstract about basic security, I think I had a lot of doubts and question marks, and let me just briefly sum them up. It seems first to me that if we speak about basic security, that we lump together three different things, at least in the abstract, which may be totally different. Security in terms of military and police, the whole post 9/11 discourse we know. Then, especially here in Germany right now, social security, and then computer network security. Are these three terms of security really the same? And is it not just that we are falsely identifying totally different things just through the fact that they have the same name, that they are being referred to by the same word? We're going to hear more about this in the talks. And then also the question of political ideology and left and right. I mean, it's, from reading the abstract, it seems to me pretty clear that it takes a kind of liberal left-wing position, but it's really not the case that it's just the political right which is pro-security and that it's the political left which is doubtful of security. But if you look closer, then you see that the so-called political right, of course, likes military security and dislikes social security, on the other hand. And the so-called left, at least in Europe, doesn't like military security, but at least in Europe, likes social security. So each of the political ideologies has their own concept of security, which they like and which they dislike, and none of them are really innocent in this whole thing of security. So do we have to question the concept of security? Which kind of security concepts do we have to talk about? Now, if I put aside all these worries and all these critical points, and I just try to take the term basic security seriously as a given, then on the other hand, maybe there is really something like social security, because we invited all the speakers here. So Transmediale sent them email, and they hope that the networks were secure enough to actually get the email across to you all. And that there was not some interception by hackers or governments or security or secret services or whatever. Then we all got you on flights here, on planes, expecting that they wouldn't crash, that they wouldn't be hijacked. And now we're meeting here in this audience, in this auditorium, and we have an assumption of basic security that, for example, there is no suicide bomber here with a bomb. And there is, unlike if we would make this conference, for example, in Israel or Afghanistan, we have no weapon screening here at the entrance hall. So maybe it is too easy to just dismiss this concept of security and say it's something reactionary or some political ideology. But in fact, maybe it is really something we rely on and just do not perceive. Question mark. It's all with question mark. Now, these are some of the questions I just wanted to briefly sketch in the beginning. Our panel will focus in the first part really on the presentations. So there will be first be Konrad, then Wendy, and then Ken. And each of them will speak about 30 to 40 minutes. It's really lectures you will get here, three lectures, solid prepared lectures I hope you will enjoy. And our plan is that if you have immediate questions because you didn't understand some concept or some English phrase, then you're free to ask a question immediately after the lecture. But we would like to go on from lecture to lecture so that we have more time then for common discussion in the end. I think this is really better. If we say we have really one block of lectures and then in the end 1 hour of discussion. So I would now, I'm about to pass the microphone to Konrad. As I said, he was for a long time the chairman of Public NetBase in Vienna. As you know, an institution that got under political attack and is in a kind of limbo right now, but he's still involved in the governing body of that institution. Among others, worldinformation.org, a project he has founded himself. He's also co-founder of the Monotone Sound Project. It's really hard to pin down his profession or activity because he's active in electronic media since 1979. At the same time, as an artist, curator, organizer, and producer. So I think he's very typical of the kind of multidisciplinary patchwork intellectual that electronic media networks have produced. He's a theorist, he's a practitioner, he's an artist and a critic at the same time, and you will see this in his presentation.
Right. Thanks, Florian, and thanks for inviting me to tell a tale of the deep and intimate relationship of art and security. And what I would like to do is sort of actually just share some observations on the of a larger field on the basics of culture and what we call risk management, sponsored by the Global Security Alliance. And let me begin with a prediction that is being made in a study on world security by the Rockefeller Fund. And what it says that we will see a dramatic return of culture on the international stage, in the sense that we will feel culture displacing military coercion as a political tool. And if we talk about a culture of security, we're talking about information mindsets and their threats and vulnerabilities, of course. And here, for instance, we can see a guideline from the OECD, who actually calls for a culture of security in information systems and calls for development of a mindset to respond to the all-pervailing threats and vulnerabilities. And of course, national security is a special form of mob mentality, but we should not be so sure, as Florian was already saying, that security is just a right-wing issue. It's actually also about securing energy for, let's say, a revolution. And so the project of cultural self-realization is actually dependent on a certain energy that has been formally expended on a struggle of survival. And then again, so artists are in a sort of caught in a difficult position here. And they're obviously forced to adapt to a world that is based on risk management and technological control. And again, there is an inherent contradiction, of course, between freedom of the art and the security culture. And basically, it also means, you know, on whose side are you on? And again, we can see that really there is no boundaries ideologically to security. For instance, if you look at some of the manuals of the leftist Latin America guerrilla, you will see some very strict regulations in response to security measures. And of course, if you go to the famous School of America, who basically is a training camp for state terrorism, it's now called the Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation, they probably have the same emphasis on security measures. So if we having a culture of security, we need an industry serving that, and it's the creative industries, of course. And in America, you have the Homeland Security Cultural Bureau, which is probably roughly equivalent to what in Britain is called creative industries. And again, of course, there's a legend to the whole story that it brings security to the artists. It sort of brings them in from the cold into the home of the entertainment military industry. So, as we can see, obviously, there's again a contradiction of a commercially driven culture in respect to issues of dissent, resistance, or autonomy, or even a culture of self-governance and justice. So, let's just look back shortly at the beginning of the modern use of the term security, and we see that actually not too long ago, sort of the word as we use it today was related to the need of actually securing the roads for commerce, for merchants, also for pilgrims. So here comes the highway police. And in 1375, there was actually a declaration to protect and secure the roads. That was the old school roads, of course. Now again, we're in a new age of digital control revolution that brings us to a new dimension in many ways. This is a beautiful oil picture, as you can see. You know, it's different to photographs, so there's a definite role in security culture for oil painting. And it's all about speed again, and the security and the speed mixes, and it's about who can protect themselves, not just best, but also fastest. And so this sort of traditional notion that we do need force, we do need sort of violence to actually uphold liberal values, to uphold civil rights, could be turned around, and there's good reasons to say that actually what drives our society is already the security complex itself. This turns into kind of a production cycle where tools and weapons are created, and again, we need more security to actually confront these new tools and weapons. And so this goes on, and it creates something like angst, and it's a whole ecology of fear that we have to look at. Some people use the categorization of pre-industrial, industrial, and global risk society, and guess what? We're in global risk society right now, and also through a extension of media, we become more and more aware of all kinds of dangerous disasters and tsunamis, and again, we might feel just more powerless to actually do something about it, which has psychological implications, of course. Again, as security is sort of a very subjective experience, which is sort of deeply rooted and can be related to very many unconscious causes and composite experiences, and the sort of the worst case scenario, the fear of death, is again also a composite experience of sort of an abstraction of statistical data. It's a subjective emotional fear, and then something what people like to call ontological anxiety. Anyway, we see an increasing risk awareness, and in a culture of a chronic anxiety zone, obviously the response, the subjective response, is not correlated to anything of a specific or real danger. And here we have the logic of stories of doom and survival and the issue of risk avoidance and social control. And the term politics of uncertainty has been introduced, which basically leads to what has been called the survivalist mentality. And so I've heard the term millennium angst on this conference already, and I guess it's related to that. And it works on a sort of subterranean level. I mean, people who talk about their panic attacks in small talk conversation, it's only a small crowd. But if you want to get an idea of what's actually happening to society, you might want to look at the influx of pharmaceuticals into major metropolis. If you look at the tons of Xanax, Prozac, Neuroleptica sort of getting transported into the urban nodes, it's quite impressive. But then again, the story, obviously, there is a political logic to that, because if we live in a world of catastrophe and doom, the best possible outcome is to survive, of course. And we don't have a choice anyway. And so any kind of aspiration for change would be extremely dangerous, and we get, you know, experts give us advice of how surviving the war, for instance. And there's a whole economy related to this. So there's the business model of paranoia. And that's, again, not politically connotated. By now, the whole spectrum of political forces is actually pro-safety, rejection of risk-taking. It's, you know, it's common sense. So passivity is actually, you know, the rule of the day. And dissent itself is a security concern by now. But then, again, it's big business. It's not just a political issue, but what has been become the called risk analysis, risk management. You know, this is like a big company. You can see this sort of original advertisement who deals with conflict. And that goes on various levels. We have sort of the virtualization of control and prisons without walls. So there's new security solutions coming up every day for maximum paranoia and profit. And prison technologies are the business of the day, and if that doesn't suffice, you have crowd control technologies, and experts say it guarantees us an iron cage for all. Okay, again, this is like a big industry, and you can switch off your mobile phone. And this is a thing that is actually on a grand scale, the privatization of conflict, the managing of difference and dissent. You can see this in the change from public police forces to private security corporations. You can see that from public prisons to private corrections management. And of course, state armies being replaced by mercenaries. As in Iraq, where about 30% of all forces are actually private companies in place. And they have an amazing range of activities to offer. So, like for instance, this is just one example. I could go on for a long time, but you know, this, the same company would do a humanitarian operation. They would do communication, public relation. But basically, if you want to take over a small country, you could book them also. So, you know, it's like hostage rescue. It kind of gets really mixed up. And so the whole concept of what is war and peace gets sort of mixed up in between. And obviously, there is an issue of surveillance beyond the theme of privacy. In our Western culture, the issue of surveillance is very much seen in the context of privacy, of intimacy, and intrusion on anonymity, which actually fails to see the real interesting part of it, which is social sorting and exclusion. And again, a quote from David Lyon, who sort of stresses the fact that this is actually a key element of reproducing and reinforcing cultural but economic divisions. So surveillance as a social technology of power, it has been obviously mentioned before and again and again. A traditional formula of managing social collectives. But now we have something more interesting. It's the network of evil eyes, and it's the center of control becoming invisible. And so we have like now surveillance systems which are loose, rhizomatic sets of processes that are not centrally coordinated or controlled. And so the evil eye is basically everywhere, and you don't have to know if it's just watching right now. It's like, you know, in this old, it's a question mark, the evil eye, is it watching you? I mean, a lot of these cameras don't work, actually, but this is not the point. And again, these sort of assemblages of surveillance can be co-opted for very conventional purposes. And again, just to, you know, make sure that we all know, the controlling center has become magical. And so talking about magic, we're talking about the charismatic domination, the game rules of culture and society. And if it is, you know, of the ideal of the Aryan family or Barbie dolls in Saudi Arabia, always to have secure hegemony, information dominance needs to embrace culture. So it needs to sort of interconnect with art and ideology. to extend mastery to a symbolic level. And that's useful on various levels because it can sort of support security operations in the sense that it actually provides a blueprint for how to behave. And it also gives us sort of our goals of what is worth pursuing and what must be avoided in such a structural game. And you know, what moves can we make? What moves can you not make? How are you expected to behave? There's a lot of subtext in a game which is actually about mapping our behavior and coding rules. As an example, for a group of artists to use the game Civilization, a simulation to actually sort of highlight the military structures of today's economy and the relation of, let's say, terrorism and pharmaceutical industry, schizophrenia and immaterial labor. So games are very good actually not to just indoctrinate but to actually also reverse engineer them into showing something else. And the bonds of the empire, sort of how the infosphere imposes itself on the geosphere, is very much dependent on the role of culture. It's about legitimization, of course, and throughout the centuries we have in the cultural field seen very often the case of fake documents sort of to legitimate, for instance, certain dynasties, hierarchies, etc. Art and culture is just perfect for that. And an aspect of the more recent history which has not been researched to the extent that it would be desirable is the issue of how culture was instrumentalized to a large scale in the so-called Cold War. Most everything that happened on a large scale in the 70s was basically part of that operation, and still is today. You know, it's about attempting to influence a global mix of emotion and cultures for a new world order, of course. And so what is called in the military technical term information peacekeeping has become cultural peacekeeping of the general intellect. And what Franco Berardi Bifo calls the militarization of the intellect as one of the main dangers in society, which is sort of supported through this development of technology in his paper Panic War in Semiocapital, which has some few other interesting quotes. And then on the other side we see the culturalization of security, and it's related to what is called technically so-called other operations than war. And it's about tactical and strategic use of cultural symbol manipulation for security management. So it's the triumphus persuasionis. And this kind of symbolic engineering of desire, of fear, of longing can be extremely effective depending on sort of various specific individual targeting. What we see now is this expanding into the so-called security entertainment complex or military entertainment complex. And the idea is that basically war has gone to Hollywood in many senses. The boundaries of computer simulations for military purposes, for entertainment purposes, and for scientific purposes for that matter are actually blurring to a large extent. So what you can see here, for instance, on the right side is a recruitment 3D shooter game based on Unreal from the American Army. It's called America's Army. On the left-hand side, you see Flashpoint, which is actually a commercially available war simulation game, which has been adapted and extensively used by the American Army. And there's people who sort of talk as the military entertainment complex of what is considered the post-human warfare of the future. And we see here a scenario, you know, this kind of logos are always beautiful and it says all but war is simulation, and you get the idea. Just another example, this here is a training rehearsal simulation from the Institute of Creative Technologies, which is actually the same company that holds a lot of the shares in Hollywood studios and digital imaging for all the movies you like to go and see. It has also been called the military Nintendo complex, which I personally find very cute, and there is good reasons for that, because all the game industry has its root in the in the military developments. And really, it's very hard to find out what is a game and what is the real thing here. I leave it up to you to guess. And it's a future where the military-industrial complex will be in cyberspace. You know, it's about information warfare, battle labs, and the Matrix, and a lot of strange fusions. And then again, this locks into what is called omnidirectional warfare, or the so-called unrestricted theaters of battle. And talking about military strategic technology, what the idea is about that this war is no longer confined to a military sphere. Actually, you have to count in everything from the cultural, technology, economic, political factors, and you know, even terrorist groups sell DVDs these days to make a living, it seems. We have like a blurring of what has so-called non-war actions on a battlefield that is virtually everywhere, and the distinction between military and non-military becomes increasingly obsolete. So the relation of fine arts and civil wars is a long one, of course. So the artistic tradition of security is, for instance, famously Sun Tzu in The Art of War. That's a long time ago. Chinese philosophers, you know, comparing warfare to a doctor seeing a patient. And for instance, Napoleon was quite keen on the subject of the art of war. And then I would like to connect it to a quote from De Boer, who was making a strong statement that any traditional form of artistic practice is not a very honorable sort of activity to devote oneself these days. We should rather consider to take on the fact that we're in a civil war and we're in a general movement of propaganda that sort of encompasses all aspects of our social reality. It's about social codes in a battlefield of human biomass, if you want. And talking about omnidirectionality, we're going to outer space. Actually, the first game for a computer, which was a mainframe computer in 1962, was called Space War, and you can see the guys just here. And in the 60s, it was like a big thing. Space is the front line. There will natural evolution, you know, this general is fantasizing about into space. And of course, 2002, space is a real priority for national security, and there's some really interesting uses for that. Expanded omnidirectionality is about exotic weaponry, directed energy weapons, and much more. But what is interesting that at the same time we have a quest for outer space, on a technological level we have a quest for inner space, communication and control, at the same time sort of the colonization of outer space, there was the big hunt for the truth serum. Basically, the industrial sort of spread of LSD and psilocybin and many other exotic drugs was due to this military intelligence effort. Quite an interesting story, really. Destination inner space. There was some hard thing. They pumped one elephant with so much LSD that he actually collapsed, you know. So this is a transition from the colonization of outer space to the colonization of the mind, the internal pacification, and the policing of the cognitive act. And, the Manchurian Candidate, the new movie wasn't too good, but it's an interesting story anyway. And security issues are related to some of the most internal processes of imagination and desire. And as Norbert Wiener, who was sort of kind of reductionist in many ways, was sort of stressing the point that this is actually a link between the inner life and communication and control on a societal level. And it's a psychological war zone. So moving on to multilateral terrorism and disapproved other, we see that in the good old days of the Cold War, peace was kept by the bomb. So it was like a bipolar situation where total annihilation was keeping peace. And now we have a different situation where it's like a network of fear. It's like a rhizomatic network of ubiquitous low-intensity conflicts with decentralized flat structures, which correspond to the modern geopolitical policies and conflict management. And again, what is a terrorist? You never know. One man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter, and basically it's violence committed by the others. So at the same token, statistics on terrorism are quite useless. Interestingly enough, in this UN chart, you see that it's on the decline, and America is hardly affected at all, Latin America a little bit. And then we have a whole culture of terror, of course, which is in many ways, as this study on terror and healing tries to make a point, related to the imaginary projection of, for instance, evil and savagery on a colonial subject. So sort of mimicking certain fantasies. We have seen one of the cruelest exploitations of torture and terror. And here is a report from a guy in the slavery days of Peru who was, you know, explaining how everybody was so paranoid that they always felt they will be getting killed. So the only way to cope with that was, of course, to terrorize and to kill in large amounts and quantities. And again, terrorism is about civilian targets. It's about us. You know, it's like, are we good? The first use of the term was related to state terrorism. And much later, it is, has also been used for anti-government activities. And what terror is all about is behavior modification in relation to anxiety. And here we actually have a definition of terror, which is from the Department of Defense. And it speaks about the calculated use of violence or threat of violence to coerce, basically, whatever government or societies to do something. So pursuit of goals. So terrorism's intent is to change behavior by inducing fear in someone other than its victims. And the anthrax scare in America has been a good example for that. The need for publicity and the economy of attention is a very important element. And you know, a lot of you are familiar with this picture here, but I just felt I had to use it. It's so interesting. And so we're talking here about the making of fear. It's actually a discipline, and people don't usually think of guerrilla tactics as a very disciplined practice, but actually it's not spontaneous or random, but it's very much calculated for its impact on an audience. And despite its character, it's actually sort of a extended psycho-mathematical manipulation, and you don't actually need to have a physical damage. So, talking about propaganda by deed, there is an sort of obvious connection between the work of the terrorist and the work of the artist, and there is, for instance, the mode of operation, asymmetric, unconventional actions, unorthodox methods of operation. This is what the military is trying to learn from artists also, and the term propaganda by deed, a historic term used in the 19th century, has begun to be redefined by people to incorporate more than just the concept of violence. So cultural guerrilla tactics, what we're talking about, and there is historic examples, some of them have been mentioned already today. And for instance, you can see a very nice example of a manual for cultural sabotage and psychological attacks from the 60s using tape recorders at that time, I understand, portable tape recorders. And it's about a terrorism of change in the sense of a psychology of change, and what it is fighting against is basically silence. It's fighting fear and it's fighting solitude. And so it's it's about stories. And it's not necessarily targeting the feelings of anxiety, but uses various methods of identity deconstruction, for instance. And obviously, if you manipulate words, you can control the meaning of words and people, but it's not just about words. It's semiotic sabotage and psychic warfare, let's say. And here again, there's a correlation between an advanced artistic practice and the operational mode and thinking that is essential to terrorist, counter-terrorist, or special operations units. So I'd like to see that actually there is a multitude of cultural terrorists at work. And of course, as I found on the website, they're attacking the foundations of Western civilization. So some of you are laughing because you might know these guys who are here as semiotic terrorists. But laugh no more, they're on the same website with Bin Laden and the rest of all of them. So it is a vortex of groups that are actually continuously dissolving and regrouping. So it's a bit, you know, brand name and art market. I'm not getting into that. But it's about psychic attacks and operations against repressive notions of identity. And of course, we're moving in several directions at once. So what I would like to end with is the notion of reverse engineering security culture and looking into some of the psychological and emotional motives of perception and representation in security culture and the economy of fear, and which is very much related to psychological states of regression and dependence. And so art and culture and secure imagination have an important role to play in the future, I believe. And well, there's an insert from a Spanish artist group, Technologies to the People, and they say, we can help, of course we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Konrad. Now we make a shift from reverse engineering security culture to insecurity culture. This is what Wendy Chun will speak about. She is an assistant professor of modern culture and media at Brown University, Providence and Rhode Island. Maybe some people of you are familiar with Brown University as always having been this laboratory for network culture and cultural investigation of computing since the 1980s and early 1990s. Wendy has a background both in systems design engineering and literary studies and cultural theory. And really, if I personally have to think of media theorists worldwide who have something to say about software and code in terms of cultural theory, I can only think about five or six people, and Wendy surely is one of them. She just has completed a book which is called Control and Freedom. Interestingly, the working title before was Sexuality in the Title of Fiber Optics, but then it became Control and Freedom, and it's going to be released by MIT Press very soon. And it researches how the internet both enables freedom and democracy and surveillance at the same time. And I think this is also will also be a topic in our talk today, how the internet and networks are double-edged swords in relation to empowerment and disempowerment.
So just to let you know, I had to change the topic of the book because the reviewers all asked me where the sex was. And so no more sexuality. Okay. So before I begin, I want to thank Andreas Brockman and the organizers of Transmediale for inviting me to this exciting event. And I also want to lay out the three major arguments that I'll be making today. The first argument is that there is nothing basic about security. Indeed, rather than a basic security, networking technologies put in place, I argue, a basic insecurity. And this insecurity, which is necessary for communications, has a rather nasty side effect, namely human paranoia. Because technology always fails, because we never really know what our computers do, paranoia, after all, is a response to uncertainty and weakness rather than overwhelming power. Because of all of this, only the paranoid, as Intel CEO Andy Grove puts it, survive. And this prudent paranoia, however, becomes reckless, though, when it bleeds elsewhere. Most specifically, when political problems are rewritten as technological ones, right? As if the technological could solve the political, as if the technological weren't itself already political. However, to be clear, paranoia and technology are not only linked through networking technologies, the very fetishization of technology is tinged with paranoid knowledge. Okay, so number two, the drive for basic security necessitates a move from deterrence to preemption, and consequently conflates security or control with freedom. And a version of freedom is emerging in ostensibly liberal democracies and technologies that is not, as in classic political theory, opposed to control, but rather indistinguishable from it. And one sees this most starkly in the gated communities, which are very prevalent in Southern California, in which people voluntarily lock themselves up in these fortress-like structures. And to be honest, whenever I drive by one, I'm always quite happy that these people are locked up. And one also sees this in the valorization of interactive graphic interfaces, which are said to free the users through simulated direct manipulation, which is, of course, neither direct nor manipulation. Okay, so number three, to insist on a basic insecurity and to reveal the conflation of freedom with control is not to denigrate freedom, but rather to call for a more rigorous freedom. The problem lies not with our vulnerability, I argue, but with our desire for and our blind belief in invulnerability. Okay, so I begin in a rather circuitous fashion with my packet sniffer. Okay. For all of you unfamiliar with packet sniffers, they're software programs that analyze local area network traffic. So Carnivore, RSG, or otherwise is a packet sniffer. Although used by artists and hackers and FBI, they were developed by SysOps to diagnose networks. And right now, you're seeing all the packets addressed to and sent by my computer. Now, some of you may think that your interface controls your computer, that your software merely transcodes inputs from ASCII to binary in order to, in Microsoft's words, let you go where you want to today. As you can see, however, your computer constantly wanders without you. Even when you're not using, your computer sends and receives and discards, that is, reads packets. Packets which mostly ask and respond to the question, can you read me? These packets are anything but transparent to you, the user. Not only must you install a sniffer to see them if you're not using a Unix-based system, you must also translate them from the hexadecimal. And you can see here an example of a packet payload. Now, screening this traffic and making analogous browsing the web and reading a page focuses attention on the text and the images pulsing from your screen rather than on the ways in which you, too, are circulated and coded, numerically, invisibly, non-volitionally. So, rather than simply allowing people to exercise what Walter Benjamin once called their legitimate claim to be reproduced, the internet circulates the reproductions without their consent or knowledge, while also giving them greater access to each other's reproductions. And indeed, the sniffer, for example, is running in so-called promiscuous mode. And thus accessing all the traffic running through this cable. And so if this is an older building, you'll be seeing everything that's going through this building. Significantly, though, promiscuous mode does not alter my normal Ethernet card's reading practices. Ethernet cards routinely read in all packets and then discard those that aren't addressed to it. For a computer, to read is to write elsewhere. So What's important about this as well is that computation's rampant reproductions also literalize control. And etymologically, the English term control is based on the French contre-rule, a copy of a rule or account of the same quality and content as the original. And this literalization of control, I want to stress, is absolutely essential. Without it, there would be no communications, no internet. The problem lies not with TCP/IP, but rather with the ways in which it is simultaneously hidden and amplified, for it, in and of itself, does not enable a global surveillance network. And indeed, the myth of the internet as Big Brother personified is the obverse and not the opposite of the internet as an agency-enhancing marketplace. For it, too, seeks to map as volitional and certain what are fundamentally non-volitional and uncertain interactions. Right? So even the U.S. National Security Agency admits this impossibility, which is why it automatically stores encrypted packets. The best way to hide is truly unencrypted in public. The enormous, constantly amassing amount of unanalyzed data belies the computer's analytic promise and demarcates the limits of an information society. And this myth also contradicts people's everyday experiences with computers. And I'm always constantly amazed by the number of people whose computers crash on a regular basis, whose email messages disappear into the ether, who can no longer read files because of software incompatibilities, whose demos never work. Yet who honestly believe in a worldwide surveillance network in which no piece of data is ever lost. So how is it that such a compromising and compromised form of communication has been simultaneously bought and sold as control and freedom? Moreover, given that networked computers engage in an incessant and non-volitional exchange of information, given that interactivity emerged within computing as an acknowledgement of the limits of human programming, so interactive operating systems emerged with artificial intelligence, why do we believe interactivity to be driven by user-controlled mouse clicks? And lastly, given that computers generate visuals rather than reveal what's really there, why do we so readily believe that my packet sniffer was actually sniffing network traffic? Indeed, I must confess that this sniffer, unlike the one I used last August in IZEA, is a fake. I programmed her in a nod to this year's transmediale theme in Real Basic. For all of you who want to see a real packet sniffer in action, though, I give you sniffles, but I must say she's rather boring because this network is actually pretty secure. So let me show you what happens. Yeah, there you are. There's the real packet sniffer in action. Okay. So the current obsession with transparency at the level of theoretical discourse, political rhetoric, and product design would seem to be a compensatory gesture. As our machines increasingly read and write without us, as they become more and more unreadable so that seeing no longer guarantees knowing if it ever did, we, the so-called users, are offered more to read, more to see. The computer, that most non-visual and non-transparent device, has paradoxically fostered visual culture and transparency. It has led to rhetorical excesses about obscenity and transparency of communication. And here I think perhaps just the name Baudrillard suffices. And to the privileging of software and interface as cause and effect in net studies and net art. This increased visualization and our consequent belief in our backgrounds as backgrounds, combined with our fear of, resignment to, and even perhaps desire for the blue screen of death, makes us more vulnerable to the control of others. It makes us vulnerable to back orifice attacks, And for all of you who don't know what back orifice attacks are, they're trojans that open up a not well-known port on your computer and turn it into a server. But of course, every computer also serves information. So back orifice attacks are only possible because of our blindnesses, because of the dominant heterosexuality and the ideas of our networking protocols. Indeed, I started working on sexuality in the age of fiber optics because as an engineer, I was fascinated by the fact that everyone kept telling me to combine the male to female connectors. And I realized around me, all my machines were having sex. Okay. So perhaps more dangerously, these visualizations and our responses to them make them more susceptible to Microsoft's agenda of fear, uncertainty, and doubt. Okay. Now, to answer these questions, I want in the rest of my talk to outline how these necessary misconceptions, and I want to emphasize these are necessary misconceptions, thrive on an imbrication of the cultural and the technological, race and technology, televisual representation, and mundane actuality, as well as the twinning of control and freedom. So, as I argue in Control and Freedom, race as skin deep has been key to understanding the internet as screen deep. In the United States especially, the internet was sold as empowering, as something desirable and necessary through images of happy people of color. And at one point, it seemed impossible to advertise the internet without seeing these happy people of color, or every movie had them, The Matrix, etc. These images and the ensuing debate over whether or not the internet was really a racial utopia displaced the then dominant paradigm of the sparsely used internet as a pornographic badlands in which no sane person would ever use their credit card or allow their children to enter. And so here are two images from 1995, Terror Online, and you see here First Contact. And for all of you, so there was a huge debate over this, and this was actually used as evidence in the US congressional debate over the Communications Decency Act. Okay, for all of you unfamiliar with these commercials, I want to show you one of the more influential commercials by MCI. Could we have sound, please?
Wir bräuchten Ton. Können wir noch Ton dazu hören?
Okay, so basically you missed like the really exciting, upbeat soundtrack, and many of the words were right there, because it's all about words, right? So the message of this commercial is not do not discriminate, but get online if you want to avoid being discriminated against. This assumes that racism naturally stems from visual markers of race, so that the solution is a forced blindness to both race and technology. MCI's message depends on seeing and knowing immediately, of course, these people would be happy to be on the internet. And it perpetuates a jealous and paranoid logic classically diagnosed by Jacques Lacan. For it's not just get online because it's happy there, but hurry up and get online because all these other people are already there, because it is already the object of another's desire. You should want it because of a mass-produced delusional advertisement. Needless to say, at the time, this was not representative of the demographics of the those on the internet. And the same companies that were airing these commercials were also participating on roundtables about the digital divide. Which is not to say that there weren't people of color on the internet, it's just that we weren't online celebrating there is no race. This visual paranoid knowledge underlies the never-ending desire for technology that the other has, or we think he has, or we think he might use against us. And let me show you another commercial that brings this out a little more clearly, and hopefully we will have sound for this one. Okay.
There are over 800,000 job openings.
There are over 800,000 job openings for internet specialists right now.
$3 million more in the next 5 years. 7 out of 10 students on the web
say they are getting better grades.
By the time I'm 18, a graduated job will require the internet skills.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready?
Be ready.
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, the same one sponsoring thousands of networking academies around the world. Internet to us, Cisco System Gatch and Admission.
Are you ready?
Are you?
Okay, so as well as celebrating the mobility of these others, we're also called on to envy them. Even though we have the privilege of observing them, and even though they're shown interacting with primitive modes of transport, we are, after all, stuck in front of the TV watching them. And I want to emphasize again that this is a televisual logic. Not surprisingly, Cisco Systems stopped running these commercials in the US after the dot bombs of 2001, running them instead in Japan, where internet usage was still low. As I'm sure you're aware, actually using the internet is not as exciting as these television commercials. And these television commercials were designed to lure people in to invest in these companies and to go online. Even without the dot bombs, however, post 9/11, Cisco Systems would not run these commercials, because post 9/11, it's not just, yay, people riding on horses in the desert have access to the internet, but, oh shit, people riding horses in the desert have access to the internet. Post 9/11, we can also see more clearly the technologically defined boundary between self and other that this propaganda maintained, even as it pretended to transcend it. The other, who always threatened to have technology, was never really supposed to have it, was never really supposed to be able to use it against us. And this televisual paranoid logic, which is almost textbook in its mirroring of self and other, I mean, you could teach Lacan with this, is supplemented by a less visual paranoia, which is crucial to the operation of technologically based preemption, that is, security. Paranoia is a valid information processing technique. Not only can paranoid interpretations be correct, but the paranoid's obsession with meaning, his or her pull towards seemingly irrelevant terms, grounds prevention in the age of fiber optics. Automatic digital storage and networks enable a post-event traceability, for a digital mass of information can always be mined for warning signs read in but not read. Search terms only become self-evident after an event. And thus, law enforcement will always appear negligent unless they are inhumanly attentive, unless they react to every single piece of stored information. Paranoia thus becomes a way of generating search terms in advance, a human response to an inhuman mass of information, a response in which some are always seen as criminals in advance. In post 9/11, there were some bizarre events. A Florida interstate highway, for instance, was shut down because a woman heard three Middle Eastern-looking men talking together and thought they were planning another attack. And so the police shut down the highway and they followed these men. And it turns out they were three medical students and there was nothing in their car, even remotely similar to a bomb. However, the police angrily stated, if this is a hoax, they will be charged. Even their apparent innocence was not enough to convince the police that these men were not in some way responsible. As one of the parents of the arrested men put it, my son was born and raised here. I feel like we don't have freedom here anymore. Anybody can call anybody to make any kind of accusation, and the authorities treat you like you are criminal. And this logic of seeing others as criminals in advance is always instigating the violence and therefore deserving the violence they receive was made most stunningly clear in the Rodney King trial. In what Judith Butler has called the inverted view of the white paranoiac, this image was read by the jury not as a man defending himself, but rather as a black male rising, as threatening violence. This image was read by the jury as threatening the barrier between white and black that the police were there to defend, the barrier that enables a certain white autonomy. Now, Lacan has also made this linkage between autonomy and paranoia. And in an analysis of the persistence of slavery in modernity, which is suspiciously bereft of any references to institutional slavery or colonization, and an erasure, I argue, that enables him to valorize the symbolic, he argues that the discourse of complete autonomy perpetuates master-slave relations or unfreedom in society today. So his argument goes like this. Autonomy or freedom seems to be indispensable to modern man. But if you quiz someone on what this independence is, he'll offer words like rights of man or the right to happiness. And soon it's clear, Lacan argues, that for each of us, this is an intimate personal discourse, which is a long way from coinciding with the discourse of one's neighbor on any point whatsoever. So in order to match up this discourse of freedom with the other's discourse and actions, there is, Lacan argues, a resigned abandonment to reality. And this is what he argues we share with all paranoiacs. Namely, a renunciation of what is nevertheless an essential part of our internal discourse. Namely, that we have not only certain indefeasible rights, but these rights are founded on certain primary freedoms, which can be demanded for any human being in our culture. Thus, this intimate discourse of freedom leads us to abandon human rights while at the same time holding on to them as delusion. Now, significantly, Lacan begs the question of a non-delusional freedom, right, and assumes that conflict automatically leads to resignation, therefore surprisingly overlooking the openness endemic to all forms of signification. If, however, we accept the notion of complete autonomy as delusional, we need to historicize this as well, because humans in the North were not always viewed as autonomous either from each other or from objects. And Michel Foucault has offered the most influential genealogy of the autonomous subject, but I would also point here to Martin Heidegger and Jonathan Crary. According to Foucault, around 1800, man appears in his ambiguous position as an object of knowledge and as a subject that knows, enslaved, sovereign, observed, spectator. Importantly for Foucault, this emergence of discipline, which is necessary for capitalism, also fosters the liberties, right? So the liberties are laid on a grid of disciplines. The disciplines thus serve as a sort of counter-law. They have the precise role, he argues, of introducing insuperable asymmetries and excluding reciprocities within a facially equal system. Okay. The terms, however, have changed since the 19th century. If then it was discipline and liberty, it is now control and freedom. It's moved from visible discipline to invisible control, from Lady Liberty to freedom fighters. And drawing from the work of William S. Burroughs, Gilles Deleuze, and following him, Alexander Galloway, have distinguished between disciplinary and control societies, arguing that disciplinary society, which was characterized by confinement and mass individuation, is giving way to control societies, which are characterized by flexibility and codes. So for example, prison techniques, which were mentioned earlier, which enable greater freedom of movement and precise tracking, and here here you see a version of it you can buy and use for your child. Control for Deleuze and Galloway is intimately linked to software. And technologically, control systems are not visible, and this non-visible and unverifiable operation of constantly failing control technologies necessitates a generalized paranoia. Indeed, Deleuze's analysis, if not paranoid, induces paranoia through its conflation of possibility and probability, through its acceptance of codes as codes. Okay, now this is not to say that Deleuze's analysis is not correct, but rather that it unintentionally fulfills the aims of control by ascribing to control power that it does not yet have. So we accept delusion as reality, we accept codes as basic. Codes are not basic. Software cannot be physically separated from hardware. Genes cannot be physically separated from DNA, only ideologically. And in the case of genes, only very vaguely, and only if we rewrite biological specificity as a type of language. As Friedrich Kittler has so succinctly put it, there is no software. Or, to spin it differently, codes are as much an effect as they are a cause. Codes, indeed, are seductive effects that concretize certain nebulous relations, such as the relationship between the mind and the brain, culture and nature. And I don't have enough time here to deal with software as an effect in detail. And for those interested, I have a forthcoming article in Grey Room that addresses this, and I'd be happy to distribute it to anyone interested. But I would like to point out that it's software that perpetuates certain notions of seeing as knowing and reading and readability that were supposed to have faded with the end of indexicality. Software, or more properly, programming languages, make the goals of so-called programming no longer a working machine. And here you see an early example of operating, which has since been rewritten as programming in light of programming languages. Programming languages developed as a means to hide the machine under the guise of empowering programmers who are treated more and more as dangerous idiots. Programming languages, which Paul Ceruzzi and Wolfgang Hagen have argued were not foreseen, separate executable from execution through a spatialization of process in order to make the execution cause. And let me unpack this a little. So Edgar Dijkstra famously condemned go-tos. And here's an example of a go-to. Go, if X, go to, another line. And he condemned these because he argued that they go against the fundamental tenet of structured programming, namely the necessity to shorten the conceptual gap between static program and dynamic process, to make the correspondence between the program spread out in text space and the process spread out in time as trivial as possible. To think about this differently, here is the code for the packet sniffer. Here is the executable. They're not only different from each other, they're also different from the execution. So why do we then believe that the code, which is itself a product of another software program and whose instructions are exploded in order to run, of course BASIC is not BASIC, why do we conflate code with the running program? What is the packet sniffer? What is Word? The emergence of software stems from our desire to make our machines readable and rational so we can cover over the fact that fundamentally we do not know what our machines do when they process, that every use is to a certain extent a supplication, an act of faith. In this sense, I would argue that we are not necessarily more computer literate now, but rather more comfortable with our ignorance. And the dissemination of software as a conceptual framework everywhere spreads this comfortable ignorance and this desperate belief in a clear causal, clear-cut causality, a dissemination that has made a return to basic language impossible. A certain failure of the symbolic is involved here, and I'd be happy to talk about this more during Q&A. Regardless, a dissemination of software, a deciphering of software, has become the new model for tearing the veil of ideology and nature asunder. And I had a section on ideology and software that I had to cut, but again, I'd be happy to go on and on about it later. Okay, so now I want to emphasize that control is only half the story. Liberty differs from freedom as discipline differs from control. Liberty, like discipline, is linked to institutions and political parties. Liberal or libertarian, freedom is not. Although freedom can work for or against institutions, it is not bound to them. It travels through unofficial networks. To have liberty is to be liberated from something. To be free is to be self-determining, autonomous. It is a state beyond formal liberty. Liberty is linked to human subjectivity, freedom is not. The US Declaration of Independence describes men as having liberty and the nation is free. Free will may have first been attributed to human will, but Newtonian physics attributes freedoms, degrees of freedoms, to free bodies, to objects. Freedom thus implies, or perhaps has become reduced to, freedom of movement. So in the US, for instance, you drive on a freeway rather than a liberty way, right? Free love and free speech move from location to location, person to person. We are free to be you and me. Freedom can or cannot exist within a state of liberty. One can be liberated yet unfree, or free yet enslaved. And Orlando Patterson has argued in his groundbreaking Freedom that freedom as a value stemmed from the yearnings of slaves. Freedom, in its current distinction from liberty, responds to liberty's inadequacies. Freedom as freedom of movement cannot easily endorse segregation. There can be no equal but separate. The freedom rides of the civil rights movement responded to emancipation's inadequacy. And crucially, this difference between liberty and freedom makes most sense in Anglo languages. U.S. politics, from segregation to late 20th century and 21st century U.S. global power, arguably generates the pronounced difference between liberty and freedom. If once it was white man's burden, it is now enduring freedom. If it was once liberty, equality, and fraternity, it is now freedom, democracy, free enterprise. And Bush's new tripartite motto erases equality and fraternity and makes ambiguous the subject of freedom. In an extension of commodity fetishism, we now wish to be as free as our commodities, and freedom becomes, importantly, what you cannot not want. How can you not want freedom? Freedom, understood as radical autonomy, is enabled by an underlying matrix of control, and we are told to take on more and more invasive technology so we can be free. Free even, and importantly, of racism, free to be individuals. And I had to take out, again, a whole section on face recognition technology. Okay. What is important, Florian made me do it, by the way. Okay. So what is important is that we not give in to paranoia, that we not give up on freedom and in the name of freedom erase the actual work of people of color. What we need is a more rigorous idea of free. And here I think free software is actually a good start. Free software is not autonomous, but deliberately builds on the work of others. Free software is free because there's a guaranteed structure of sharing and continuity. But what we must remember is that if nothing can be controlled, if something cannot be controlled, it is freedom. Freedom comes without guarantees. Freedom, as Jean-Luc Nancy argues, is a fact. It is not an innocuous thing that we can own or grant another. Freedom entails a decision for good or evil. It is not either good or evil in and of itself. Freedom, he argues, is an experience. Here you see the happy face recognition technology. Here we are. Freedom is an experience, an attempt executed without reserve, given over to the peril of its own lack of foundation and security in this object of which it is not the subject, but instead the passion, exposed like the pirate who freely tries his luck on the high seas. Now, I do have some reservations with Nancy's formulation, which I won't go into. But I find it useful because he stresses that freedom always precedes being. There is being because there is freedom. Now, to reduce it grossly to mundane technological terms, it is because there is freedom that there are decisions to be made and control systems to automate them. Classic cybernetic control systems produced a steady response in the face of external or internal perturbations. They automate the decision process both by sampling output and by assuming that one steady state is desirable. And if I had a blackboard here, I would draw you the negative feedback classic picture. Okay. But they therefore assume that a certain unpredictability and resistance, a certain free will, that is, which is why in classic information theory, it's reduced to, let me start that again. They therefore assume a certain unpredictability and resistance, a certain free will that is, in classic information theory, reduced to a noble number of free choices. And this is why Warren Weaver considers information to be the measure of freedom within a system. And Burroughs, as well, insists that you can only control things with free will. So this automation of response and responsibility brought about by control systems, however, is never complete. There are always moments when our rules and systems fail us, when our choices are not knowable in advance, and yet when we must make a decision. Moments when we truly, as Thomas Keenan argues, face responsibility. So control systems cannot relieve us of responsibility, and it's in their very failure, still, their constant, always failing, that we face the need to respond. To conclude, to seize the democratic potential of fiber optic networks, we must reject understandings of freedom that make it into a gated community writ large, that reduce freedom to the freedom of a commodity within a free market. We must take seriously the vulnerability that comes with communications, not so that we simply condemn or accept all vulnerability without question, but so that we can work together to build vulnerable systems with which we can live. Danke.
As Wendy has pointed out, the job of the moderator is to put a restraint on freedom and secure the panel. Yeah, so see my dilemma, but indeed I was enforcing these cutbacks on the manuscript so that we now have the freedom to proceed without me interrupting you. You see, this is the freedom you gain through the controls. Maybe we can discuss more about this. But so I now take the freedom to introduce McKenzie Wark. He's an Australian-American media theorist, teaches at the New School in New York City, and is author of several books, The Virtual Republic, Celebrities, Culture, and Cyberspace. I have a particular fondness of his collection of experimental essays, Dispositions, and now the new book, A Hacker Manifesto, which he told me next week will also appear in German, CH Beck Verlag. And I have a particular fondness of them because they really grew out of network discourse, especially on the NetTime mailing list. He says from about himself that he's a crypto-Marxist. I think for me he's even less cryptic than other so-called post-Marxists, because I really like about his work that he talks in a very clear and no-nonsense way about the issue of class, which other Marxists, neo-Marxists are avoiding these days. And in Ken's case, I find very refreshing. And as I said, I find it very notable. It's really, he's a rare case of, I don't know how many media theoreticians on the world who not only work in academia, who not only have a historical focus, but actually are in the midst of those medias with all their all their discontents themselves. He's one of the main contributors and thinkers on the NetTime mailing list, also was a co-editor of the NetTime anthology. And I don't know what you are talking about, because I didn't have your manuscript beforehand, so I'm now totally giving up control and
giving up control. Yeah. Thank you, Florian. We're on the screen. Fabulous, thank you. Securing security, I've called this. How one forgets. What was the ideology for which the Allies supposedly fought in World War II? Who remembers the four freedoms? They were these. Freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom from want, freedom from fear. It's still not a bad list. Only now, in what was formerly the United States, I'll argue why I say that, perhaps the demand could be for four new freedoms. Freedom from religion, freedom from speeches, we just had the State of the Union, so that's why I put that in, freedom to desire, and freedom from security. Of these four demands, I will talk only of the last. What is the basis of security? What secures security? And I would argue its absence. Insecurity secures the necessity for security. The threat to security is, oddly enough, security itself. We have nothing to secure but security itself, with apologies to FDR once again. States act in the name of security, but what could be more Orwellian? The security state is an engine of violence. What secures the state is the production, precisely, of insecurity, preferably of a kind that is manageable. Insecurity, getting out of hand every now and then, is actually not the worst thing. For the state, it's good for business. As the American GIs used to say, death is our business and business is good. What is really threatening to the security state is the prospect of peace. From this point of view, the implosion of the Soviet bloc is a disaster. People really started to think about dismantling the security apparatus in the United States. There was even talk of a peace dividend. I'm still waiting for that check in the mail. Thankfully, insecurity has returned to the scene, and all is well for the stockholders of the military entertainment complex. Threats appear to abound, and their existence creates the appearance of necessity for the military apparatus, and the necessity of appearances for the entertainment apparatus. And let's not forget how those two are linked. The military entertainment complex is not quite the same as the former military industrial complex. Its infrastructure is not so much mechanical as digital. Everything we see here at Transmediale is part of its progeny. Where did the military entertainment complex come from, one might ask? The military industrial complex produced ever faster, ever more complex machines for human warfare and welfare. So fast and so complex that they called into being whole new problems in surveillance and logistics, planning and command. The military industrial complex struggled to secure for itself a second nature, in other words. It transformed nature into second nature, into a world that could act as the object of an instrument, a standing reserve. But this act of transforming the world piecemeal into objects creates a supplementary problem, the problem of the relationship of these instruments to each other. Work on this problem calls into being, initially, as a supplement, the digital as a technological effect. Computing meets communication and simulation. But eventually, these technologies no longer supplement the world of the machine, they control every aspect of it, or appear to. Thus, not a military-industrial, but a military-entertainment complex. Not the world as made over as a second nature, but the world made over as a third nature. The digital embraces not just logistics and command, but the fantasy and creation of threats to security and means to secure. The work of the military-entertainment complex is two-sided. It has its rational, logistical side, but it also has its romantic, imaginative side. The latter invents reasons for the former to exist. Insecurities cannot simply be taken as given. That's no way to build a growth industry. They have to be fabricated out of whole cloth. And to quote my fellow panelist, Konrad Becker, with hindsight, whole empires could turn out to be the product of cultural engineering. The rise of the military entertainment complex is the mark of a society in decline. What was once the United States is no longer a sovereign state. It has been cannibalized by its own ruling class. They are stripping its social fabric bare. They have allowed its once mighty industrial complex to crumble. There's nothing left but to loot the state, abolish taxes on capital, and move all essential components of the production process elsewhere. From now on, what was once the United States lives on whatever rents it can extract from an unwilling world. It has only two exports, guns and information. It has declared all invention or creation to be its private property. Your culture does not belong to you. You will have to rent it back. You'll have to rent back your own unconscious. Unable to compete with others in an open market, what was once the United States finds itself reliant on force and the threat of force to find new ways to expand. Iraq may be in part about oil, but it's also about the contracts to rebuild everything destroyed by the last decade of sanctions and war. In short, the military entertainment complex has entered into a vicious cycle. It imagines threats so that violence may be unleashed against them, whereby producing the cause after the fact. Which came first, security or insecurity? Which came first, the chicken or the egg? Or as Marshall McLuhan, I think, rather nicely puts it, from an egg's point of view, a chicken is just a way to get more eggs. We might similarly say that from security's point of view, insecurity is just a way to produce more security. Really, it's just a way station in the self-reproduction of security. Yes, I know, the planes that crashed into the World Trade Center were real. One could say the same thing about the bombing in Madrid. And so has bin Laden. But who called him into being and why? Perhaps it was the Pakistani secret police. Perhaps it was the CIA. Perhaps it was Saudi Wahhabis. He was an agent for subversion of Soviet control of Afghanistan, but imagined that this was a threat to American interests and why? But who imagined this was a threat to American interests and why? Did the image of insecurity produce the real security that produced this real security that has in turn produced the image of insecurity on which the security state now rests? Trying to uncover the real behind the image here, of course, only leads to bad infinity. As Guy Debord says, the goal of the integrated spectacle is to turn revolutionaries into secret agents and secret agents into revolutionaries. This prophetic statement tells us a lot about what transpired around the year 1989, for example, in Romania, I suspect also in East Germany. And it perfectly describes Alawi, Chalabi, and the various other talking heads that now populate the chat show formerly known as CNN. The integrated spectacle, or what I would call the military entertainment complex, is the producer of a continuous non-dialectical relation between security and insecurity. They're essentially the same concept. Security produces sameness out of itself. But there is a complication. What security really fears is the people it claims to secure. It fears their desire for peace. Security has to project insecurity without to secure its own interiority. As David Harvey says, the evil enemy without becomes the prime force through which to exercise or tame the devils lurking within. And so, the Iraqi charade, where on second thoughts you might update and amend Debord. The goal of the military entertainment complex is to turn mercenaries into patriots and patriots into mercenaries. The devil lurking within the United States is, if anything, a people completely indifferent to the security state that rules over them. After the end of the Cold War, people began to question its necessity. That this questioning was best expressed by Newt Gingrich is, if anything, an index of how compromised the Democratic Party was by the military entertainment complex and the manufacture of insecurity for security's sake. Now, I hesitate to call this people and their desire for peace a multitude. There's an abandoning of the thread of class analysis in Hart and Negri. The concepts of empire and multitude grow out of and transform the anti-imperial side of critical thinking, not its anti-capitalist side. Yet what we see most clearly in the United States is a sharpening, not a lessening, of what the Republicans themselves describe quite openly as class warfare. The difficulty for thinking through class in America is that the classes have changed. The ruling class is itself split. A new ruling class is being born. Where a capitalist class depended on a certain stability within the space of the United States, where it held costly long-term investments in plant and infrastructure, the new ruling class, what I call a vectoralist class, has few such commitments. It rules not by controlling the material, but the immaterial. It controls the production process through the ownership of information and the means to realize its value, which what I would call the vectoral. The owl of Minerva flies at dusk. We talk now of homeland security precisely because it is disappearing in the most basic political economic sense. It's not so much that one's job is now in India or China, but that it could be. The power of the vectoralist class is a power of logistics, of imagining and ordering a world of information, a third nature, which orders a world of things, a second nature, which orders what was once a natural world somewhere. I think the concept of nature always appears retrospectively after we've transformed it into something else. What is the relation between the rise of the vectoralist class and the transformation of the military-industrial complex into the military-entertainment complex? It's both agent and beneficiary. One notices, even while the United States is using an old-fashioned army to occupy a country, that the so-called revolution in military affairs is proceeding apace. Every ruling class imagines military power in its own image, and the Vectorist class is no exception. It imagines warfare as third nature, as a video game of data management in real time. And so, we confront a rising form of power based on a new class formation, which nevertheless is a decadent one. How are we to confront it, or perhaps better, to escape it? If the example of critical art ensemble tells us anything, is that we cannot avoid the problem, but that prudence may be the better part of valor. And I want to really conclude with this quote from Agamben. In the final analysis, the state can recognize any claim for identity, but what the state cannot tolerate in any way is that singularities form a community without claiming an identity, that human beings co-belong without a representable condition of belonging. And as much, I frankly dislike Agamben's argument about bare life, but this more positive imagination that he has of what's outside it, I find tremendously illuminating, and that quote would kind of sum it up. And it might perhaps describe a strategy for tactical media and indeed for tactical reality. In an age of third nature, under the reign of the military entertainment complex, animated by the power of the Vectoralist class, under cover of the ideology of security. Thank you.
No, that was a very concise statement. And it seems to me that between your two presentations, Ken and Wendy, there was a certain contradiction or a different concept of security and insecurity. Because Ken, you said that talking about security and insecurity is like a chicken and egg problem, and that the security complex produces insecurity as its own maintaining discourse. Now, as I understood Wendy, your presentation, arguing for a basic insecurity, you have a more almost ontological concept of insecurity. So do you see this contradiction yourself, and how would you argue for it or resolve the contradiction?
I think it's just, the parable of the blind man and the elephant. You know, everybody's got a different part of the elephant, you know, and I think that's the situation here. And I love that statement about the priority of freedom over being. For me, that's kind of a given. I think both of what we're saying can be connected to that sort of larger and more abstract statement.
I would agree with that, and perhaps one way to view it instead of a basic insecurity would be a basic vulnerability, which therefore part of the reasons, of course, we're talking about security is because Andreas asked us to. But I think that perhaps the term we're working with, and hopefully the elephant has not OD'd on LSD, is precisely the question of vulnerability. And why is this sort of insecurity, this other notion of insecurity, as opposed to a basic insecurity, being produced through this other need for security?
The tactical usefulness of insecurity is then you have to think about collaboration. Judith Butler makes this argument that we're dependent on each other because of the vulnerability of ourselves and bodies. Right. I think there's a usefulness in heading in that direction.
So is then the term, the concept of security, useful for anything except describing its ideology? I mean, is that the bottom line of all your talks, that we say the term, the concept of security, is simply a certain political ideology which we don't subscribe to?
Well, I guess, it appears like that. But then again, I mean, the elephant that was mentioned, you know, there's the tusks and the legs, and I guess we could find some other, you know, like the ear, for instance. And so starting with rephrasing that, for instance, insecurity as instability. And so, I don't know, I mean, that's probably not exactly correct, but somewhat of an opposite of instability is senility. And senility is a real sociological problem, you know, because senile people are, you know, there's just too much of them, and they always feel very insecure, and that sort of stops things moving on.
Any statements from you about that?
Can't top that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it seems to me that we are in a kind of dead end, and I try to cut the Gordian knot anyway by throwing in some statements. First of all, I really would like to invite the audience. I mean, for example, here in Europe, in and especially in Germany, we have a discourse of social security. Now, is it true that all of you agree with us that security is just an ideology, or is it possible that you may have different opinions on that? It's the one thing. But since I don't see anyone stepping to the microphone right now, let me just pose a very simple question.
Yeah? Well, perhaps we could get the lights on so we could see you all and you could see us. And
yeah.
We could make eye contact.
Ist es möglich, das Licht im Saal ein bisschen zu verändern? Das wäre nett.
Can I just say two things?
Can I ask a question from the audience?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
Here.
Where are you?
Here.
Here. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you see me?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Perhaps part of the problem, the way you talk about security, is global security. So in other words, the presupposition of your dialectics of supplementarity, of insecurity and security, is a universalizing discourse. It covers everything. So the moment security is scaled down, like social security, for instance, it's a totally different matter. So is the fact that you are still accepting a universal discourse on security, that explains why you can't escape. But perhaps it's an interesting exploration to find scaled forms of security, or layered forms of security, so that there's always something outside security.
Yeah, it comes out of taking differences prior to identity, of movement as prior to enclosure. It's just a basic philosophical supposition that one makes, and there's a romantic wing to, I have to confess, card-carrying Deleuze, and we all kind of think like this, but there's a romantic side to that philosophical movement that only sees movement and nomadism and so on, and doesn't see the necessary tension between movement and enclosure.
Yeah.
But it's thinking very much about enclosure or security, if you like, as always being kind of temporary, but as tending to rigidities that in the long term will be harmful. And one risks a comment on local situations at one's peril, but as an Australian, we lived through the transformation of the welfare state under pressure of global capitalism 15 years ago, because we were not protected by being big and central and powerful, but we've been there. And I think the lesson of that experience was that transformation of the social security state that was led by the trade union movement was actually in the long term successful. And the working class is actually better off through the transformation. But it was a very, very hard struggle. And it was very, very hard to make alliances that would make that possible. But it's, seen even in those terms, it was a question of not being wedded to this enclosure, this security, but being wedded to, in this space of flows, what is it that can be secured and how? And that's going to always to be kind of a shifting thing.
Yeah, so it's finding the specific scale to talk in a positive way of security.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, one encloses, it's like the bubble that forms on the stream. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But if we agree with that, that already means that we have problems with the term of basic security. I mean, for me, the concept basic security, with the basics here screened onto the wall in these big capital letters, seems to imply that there is something like a universal notion of security. And mainly our basics are that we don't believe in these basics. That would be perhaps the first way of summing up our positions.
Right. But also, I would push the notion here that security is only ideological, because I don't know what that means, only ideological. The other thing I would say is, for me, what is less interesting is, okay, let's break these down into different things, but what made all these things be looped together in the first place? What is the political utility of this bringing together? And for me as well, it's a return to this notion of security as free from care. And really for me, and what I was discussing and why I started with the packet sniffer, is because I think the notion of security, especially network security, is entirely material. And why I argue we need vulnerable systems we can live with is because we need to deal with this fundamental vulnerability in order then to decide on what other thing we can build networks.
Mm-hmm. There's somebody else in the audience.
Yeah, I've actually been kind of surprised that I've been missing a word here the entire day, is that trust. Mm-hmm. And that really surprised me a lot. obviously, to security, there are two levels. The thing that, you know, I believe that, you know, nobody has a bomb here and blows me up, and then the actual reality of that somebody may actually be blowing up a bomb here. And so it's kind of like trusted and trustworthy, you know, that kind of difference there. And I think Wendy mentioned a key concept there, but I didn't think she made it clear enough, was transparency. For example, when she put up that packet sniffer in the beginning, I trusted that was actually a real packet sniffer, and it wasn't, you know, because I trusted her, because I thought, you know, in that situation it would make sense. And for example, if I pull up Google, I trust that they order the results in a sensible manner. But it's not really that, you know, I mean, I'm delegating control here because I trust them. So, and that's the key thing, that, you know, central control is not bad by definition, you know, it's having the choice of delegating the control or not delegating it. You know, I have the choice of, you know, wading through the entire net on my own. So I think those are key concepts that I thought that were kind of missing from the discussion up till now. So
in fact, we
absolutely right. And Wendy and Florian discovered exactly that in the conversation. But you know, like an idiot, I'd already written the paper and I didn't put it in. But yeah, absolutely right.
Yeah, no, we were discussing his scenario earlier, and I said, isn't that trust rather than security? The other thing I would, though, talk about in terms of trust is also this sort of giving over. It's an act of faith, right? And isn't that how we deal with computers to a certain extent? And so, for me, trust is a rather loaded issue. Of course, in the corporate world, there's all this work on trust management, right? And how can we build in certain trust management, and how does this operate? For me, perhaps we need to talk about it just not in terms of trust, but also in terms of a certain faith that we now have with computation, precisely because, you know, truly on your own, you couldn't surf the web. I mean, there's a way in which truly on our own, we can't understand things. I mean, you know, Google is a database, right? We always realize this. There's bots that work and blah, blah, blah. So for me, that is the important issue. The act of faith and what's involved in that act of faith and how that links to certain notions of visualization and how we can deal with the fact that it is an act of faith.
Just one thing, though. In the American discursive space, it may not apply here, but trust, I think, has to be recaptured from the right. There's a whole kind of neoconservative movement based around that very concept. So there's kind of work to do to, I think, reclaim it. Precisely that, you know, self-organized human sociality is necessarily based on trust. It doesn't necessarily require sort of institutional constraint from above, would be the argument one might make.
Yeah, I wanted to ask something, but possibly also in the relation to trust, I also wanted to say that the discussion of security and insecurity would also bring up a question between trust and probability, because I guess especially the issue of security is manufactured as much as trust is and also used. But going back to the question of security and the somehow impossibility to really find anything good in that, I guess more than trust, to me it's important to think about the relationship between security and responsibility in the relation to governance.
Any takers?
Yeah, I'm waiting for Wendy because you actually put responsibility in the paper.
Oh, yes, in okay. The paper. Everyone's waiting. Well, then I must respond. So I think the linking of trust and probability is actually really important. And it's a very scientific notion of trust, right? Why do you trust something? It's because something is predictable. And I find probability in and of itself to be fascinating. This goes back to my engineering background, because statistics and probability come in precisely when you don't know when something will happen. And it's an admission that there is individuality, that we no longer have these types, we don't have Newtonian physics, now we have a fundamental insecurity. And so prediction and trust are linked precisely in that move towards an acknowledgement of uncertainty. And that is a very interesting move. In terms of the linkage of trust and responsibility, the thing I would say, and what's really important to me in terms of responsibility, and again goes to my fascination with feedback loops and programming, is that there's a way in which we can put in place mechanisms that are supposed to automate our decisions that sort of look over the fact that responsibility is precisely that moment of not having rules to fall back on, yet I must respond to you. And that, to me, is the key question of responsibility. And this is where you could say, therefore, then it becomes a moment of trust. Maybe this is what we're talking about, the moment in which I cannot know absolutely, and yet I must respond to you in certain ways. And that I think, is absolutely key. And again, you know, probability and automation is important as well. How could we live if we were always facing this kind of dramatic responsibility? It would be impossible. So clearly, control technologies have the role to play. But I think what we always need to look for are the ruptures and the moments in which responsibility is still opened, in which action always takes place. Because there, I think, the computer or automation can never fully enclose the notion of trust. And this is why trust comes up over and over again.
I was a bit nervous about responsibility because I think it heads in a kind of theological direction. That there's some like great and mysterious other that one is answerable to, and I just totally reject that. I think one can work outward from trust, that it's a kind of positive, affirmative gesture which builds community outwards rather than kind of the great negative of the other kind of staring over your shoulder. I'm not a fan of Levinas and where that's taken us, in other words.
But to bring it down to a more practical example, maybe an example many people can relate to, is it always really a contradiction between freedom and control? Because maybe freedom and control are in contradiction if control is exercised by one over another. But for example, if I want, for example, to control this machine, then this also enables my freedom to control this machine. So the practical example would be that because of the security problems, and now I call them this way because that's the technical term, the security problems of networks and operating systems, most people today are not empowered, as you said, to serve the web, to run their own little home servers, simply because you need to be a fully skilled, trained system administrator and put several hours of work into your running system every day in order to prevent it from being hacked. Now, I know examples of independent net cultural, net art projects which disappeared because they got cracked because of vandalism, and they simply didn't have the skills, didn't have the capabilities of maintaining these servers. So the fact that there is a security problem, technically speaking, only in that realm of computing, leads to a lesser freedom and to an empowerment of the corporate giants who can serve the web because they have the manpower and the capabilities. So can't we also think of security in specific areas as a concept, first of all, that makes sense, or that simply is a reality you have to deal with, and secondly, something that is not reactionary but actually linked to the individual empowerment of people?
Well, wouldn't it be a little bit scary if examples of net art existed forever without ever coming down? I mean, maybe it's a good thing if things come down. I mean, every other category of aesthetic creativity is subject to decline and wear and tear and so on. So, I mean, conservation is this enormous problem, particularly with modern works. Why should it not surprise us? Maybe there's a little too much securing, frankly. Maybe if, you know, artworks just kind of decline like the rest of the things that we make, that would not be such a bad thing. It gives us the reason to create new ones.
Yeah, I think there's a lot that can be said for death and destruction, actually. I mean, some people will never change their ideas. I mean, basically, you have to get rid of them in a biological way. And, I mean, with some art, you know, I mean, thank God there is fashion, you know, because fashion is like a shark in the ocean. It just kills all this sort of art that's out there, you know, and it's sort of ready for dinner. And anyway, you know, so I would, you know, this was the question of terms that are being appropriate by the right wing or by the religious right, whatever, you know. I'm always for it, you know, to have it back, you know. I even want to reclaim art, so and security and trust, with, you know, all with that. And actually, I do see a role in for security. I mean, I've been involved in a lot of, you know, open source, open cultures, free whatever things, and people have been telling me, you know, maybe you should focus on conferences on secrecy, you know, and I have to agree, because this is sort of secure communication on sort of new levels of social organization. We're talking about cells, for instance, here. Steve Kurtz was saying that the FBI got really nervous when they were looking at their structure and mode of working, because it's like a cell, so it must be, you know, terrorists. And then I would like to remind you that most everything that is fun, you know, is illegal. So basically, watch your words, and secure communication on that level is very important. And because it was sort of mentioned in relation to this issue of responsibility and trust, and it's the prisoner's dilemma. And then we see sort of in a serial timeline of cooperation, we can actually see that the prisoner dilemma can have another ending than the one that is in the books.
I mean, a virus is just nature's way of telling you not to use Windows. And the more computers it pulls down, the better. People will figure out it out sooner or later that something has to change. You know, Nietzsche says we learn through pain, and one needs that exposure to the possibility of harm in order to grow and to change and transform. And the risk of securing things is that they don't change. We have the illusion of eternity within a bubble, and things don't change. That's a problem at all levels, but particularly in the art world and particularly in the digital world.
I think there are two people here at the microphones. I cannot see it clearly, but I think you want to speak. Yeah, is it true?
There are three people, I think. Okay,
sorry.
I'd first of all like to thank Wendy for picking up on issues of race and technology, because that comes up very rarely. So thank you very much. I start with questions for Wendy. Just to clarify, you did say you see some potentials in free software. I'd like to get some more information on that, if that's possible. And the other one is, you talked about building vulnerable systems together, and I was wondering about if it is possible to think of a model where we negotiate our security. I'm working on a concept called multilateral security requirements analysis, and that's basically not about securing systems, but securing, or let's say, finding out about the security interests of all the stakeholders in a system and negotiating that, or producing systems that negotiate that. And I'm wondering if that's a model. And also security as not, I think like there was the word of secrecy, and I was thinking of this example, anonymity might give me some security if I want to say things that I don't really want to be accountable for, but sometimes I want somebody I'm communicating with to be accountable. That's also a security interest. So I don't want them to be anonymous. And as a person, that is a security interest of mine, especially when I'm communicating with these sweet companies. So I'm wondering if there is a possibility of this kind of model for vulnerable systems, as you said. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. In many ways, yes, that exactly sounds like the mode of negotiation through which we would be going through to build vulnerable systems with which we could live. And I would also point to the very beginnings of the internet, and amongst certain researchers, there was a certain understanding of what these protocols would do and how they were going to work with them together, which was a negotiation, which had nothing absolutely to do with the notion of security. Security came in only after, once you wanted to have commercial transactions. So there was already there a notion of negotiation that was in place. And so there, I think you've sort of pointed towards building vulnerable systems we can work, we can live with. The other vulnerable systems that I like are really produced. Do you all know Mongrel? They're my favorite NetArt group. They're mongrelx.org, and they have this great search engine called Natural Selection. And it's no longer working, although I think Graham did get it up again. It's a standard search engine if you put in normal terms. Do you all know about natural selection? Am I just going over something you all know? No. Okay. So if you put in normal terms, you get normal output. It's just a hack of a search engine. But if you put in certain racialized terms, then you get put into what they call their, what do they call it exactly, their side world of demented content providers. And so if maybe I could just show you natural selection. So Or I can get this up in a second. So what happens is when you type in something like a racist term, you get put into a term, a site that makes you question it. So if you put in, say, you know, have you, Asian always comes with, up with pornography, right? So if you put in Asian, you get put into Goldhorn's racially mixed fuck fantasia or something. And it's a way of sort of taking on directly these notions, and also there's other sites that make you aware of various tracking or devices to make you sort of deal with and question what you're dealing with. Now, free software, that's in and of itself a huge topic, and I was pointing towards it because I think in some ways it's been over-glorified, and I think there are problems with free software, but what I think makes free software free is precisely this notion of an ingrained form of sharing. That what it talks about is not this idea of autonomy, but rather a forced sharing. And that's what I find productive about this notion of free. And then just if I can comment briefly on what we were talking about earlier, for me it's not clear that empowerment equals freedom, first of all. And secondly, if we're going to talk about security in sort of the idea of it being secure from care or free from care, one of the most compelling visions I've ever had of this comes from Frederick Jameson when he argues we can't imagine utopia. And if we were to imagine an existence that would be free from care, it would be so something animalistic, something so outside of our vision of security, that I think that to rethink security in that level is really an important challenge, and that what would be secure is not what we imagine secure to be.
Okay, I would like to the audience to make more comments, yeah.
There's a very interesting turn in the discussion, which I think either goes the wrong way or has to be reinterpreted again. Because when I understood well what was told about freedom and autonomy, freedom was discerned from liberty. And when we talk about responsibility, of course we talk about freedom, not about liberty. But when we are going to talk about freedom in terms of accountability, we are no longer talking about responsibility. And that's the whole issue, I think. Because I was at this iRite Info meeting. And in the iRite Info meeting, they showed how difficult it is to establish a proof for you for illegal downloading or uploading. That's really a problem. So how can you be a responsible user when you don't have the information to make a responsible decision? So what happens now as a result of the acceleration of the communication processes and the complexification of the processes is that we can no longer be responsible. We can only be accountable or justifiable. So once you start translating your responsibility into accountability, we're in the realm of liberties and not in the realm of freedom. So there's a very, very, it's very subtle, but something happens. And I think that we can no longer be free because we can no longer be responsible because the process is that complex and that fast that we only afterwards, in risk society, we can be accountable. We have a completely time, the time anticipation is different from in responsibility, that's the now, like the guilt is the past, but the time anticipation of accountability is the future, what might happen, and that's exactly what this global security is about. So I wonder whether this is a real solution.
Mm-hmm. Take us.
There's a sort of discourse of the sort of the tyranny of the other. That one must know, we must know by any means necessary what the other is, and all bets are off until that is, I want to say accounted for, but if you like, stated, delineated. And that strikes me as a kind of philosophical kind of road to hell that one has to kind of work outwards. And without kind of predicating on the other, on whatever is kind of beyond. Accountability, I mean, in English, I don't know in German, but it's got a kind of quantitative side to it as well. And the shift from responsibility to accountability is the way I would see it, is that accountability has become the term. And it's very much about quantifying the other, that we kind of failed to discursively account for the other. We dethroned God, didn't quite figure out what to put in its place. So we're just going to like count whatever is out there as
what
stands.
It's a legal term. That's why I said justifiability. So we're always thinking, or we are forced to think within a terrorized society, to think responsibility in legalized terms.
Yeah.
As a result of which, in risk society, this legalized terms point you towards a future in the terms of the system, always.
Right. Yeah.
So you should reject the law, in a sense.
Yes, yes. And it's double, which is quantification, because they're both a kind of foreclosure of the future. The future can only be more of the same in that world. Were it the only world there is, of course, fortunately, it is not. But this is a power in the world that a set of, if you like, between accounting and law, that the space of the future is already defined as an other of a certain kind, and that there can be no other. Okay. Yeah. There is another world. It is this one, as Paul Eluard said. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wendy, did you want to say something?
Yeah. Just in terms of how you were formulating it, I think I know McKenzie. You were addressing it because in many ways, when you said, "How can you be responsible to make a decision?" I think, and you were talking about in terms of digital rights management, you were really talking about accountability, right? In terms of the time lag, I would absolutely agree that the time lag is important. And this is the argument that I make in terms of the notion of the panopticon, is that the panopticon can't address what's happening now precisely because there is a time lag. If the panopticon was supposed to work in real time per se, it's now not that someone could be looking, but at some time in the future somebody could look. And that there's this time lag that's absolutely crucial, but it's also the could, right? It's always technologically materially mediated. It's not an absolute certainty. And so I think the question of the future is precisely where the question of the response comes in. Because what can be accountable or what can be delineated can never entirely subsume the future.
Well, I have to say, Foucault is just dead wrong about the panopticon. Bentham's pamphlet was called The Panopticon or New South Wales. I'm from New South Wales. The British went for the other solution. They did not build a technology of enclosure. They built a technology of movement.
But even if Foucault was
right. The whole discourse is misconstrued.
Yeah, but that was already concluded because Foucault, when he's right, he's right about the 19th century and a half of the 20th century.
So no, not at all. Completely wrong.
Well,
it was a minor and secondary moment. Absolutely minor and secondary.
I'd like to lend the time machine of yours and get back.
What comes out of the counterexample is the British Navy. If you want to understand what's happening now, I mean, there's no break. When Deleuze then says, "Oh, there's a break," and we have the disciplinary regime and then the control regime. Not at all. We have this massive continuity of vectoral technologies all the way from the 18th century, and we've just kind of misconceived the moment, precisely because Foucault is writing about a kind of French counterexample, but it's a counterexample to the major line of history and the line of movement at the time.
But you agree that we, whatever was, we have to think what is happening now.
Which then gives us pause to reconceive what the past was.
Yeah,
where
right.
Foucault quite correctly says we need a history of the present. It's just it's not okay. His. His
okay.
is the wrong one.
Exactly.
But
okay.
Again, he talks about the swarming of the disciplines, and in many ways the question of movement is actually there. I mean, the panopticon is the example that's always taken up, but within it, I mean, I think in this sense, Deleuze is wrong in his reading of Foucault. To insist that Foucault is always talking about certain enclosed space, because I think the question of movement is certainly there, but I think the privileging of the panopticon, I would.
Yes, you're dead wrong. I mean, Joseph Banks, the Florilegium, the relationship between the discovery of the South Pacific and the rise of empiricism, he has nothing to say about this.
Okay, but apart from Foucault, we started with the notion of responsibility. So when we talk about responsibility, I think, and that would be a statement, I think it's impossible, it will be more impossible to be responsible. And that says something about the possibility of being free.
Well, respond. I mean, it puts the emphasis always on the other. One is waiting for the call. That's why I reject it.
But perhaps being free means rejecting the media.
I don't even know if we can mount a concept of freedom at the moment, given how much it's a term that's been co-opted by commodification and equated basically with pleasure or with fun. Whereas Nietzsche is quite right that it's kind of dangerous and difficult and something we actually usually would prefer not to confront.
Yeah.
There's a line through to Sartre there as well on the same heading. So I think it's not a term you can kind of grapple with so much, precisely because I'm immediately thinking of TV ads that show SUVs in slow motion winding down country roads. I think that's kind of co-opted the term, and maybe we need to like think around it. There's certain terms should be given a rest for certain periods of time. Mm-hmm. I vote for public being retired for at least 5 years, frankly. Freedom, I think, maybe for the rest of the millennium.
Okay, we had two people here, and I think, I'm not sure, but the person in the audience is right. You want to go first? Okay, all right. So then maybe you both speak one after another. Maybe that would be helpful in that case.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm just curious to hear the panelists' thoughts or impressions about any specific biometric systems, smart cards, U.S. visit, anything along those lines. Mm-hmm. So that's my question.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to interject another thought that, you know, I'm German, so I have a huge trust in institutions. So
I'm Canadian. Yeah.
So, for example, to me, like a policeman with a gun is actually securing my safety, and I feel good, and I feel more free in that situation because I don't have to worry about other things. You know, I don't have to worry about somebody trying to kill me because the policeman is there. From your speeches, you know, I actually got really scared of security. So, I just wanted to say that, you know, for a huge chunk of the world, security may be a good thing, you know, because, you know, Germans don't live for the day, they live for the future. You know, they have this plan ahead, you know, and if there's no security, you know, everything goes to hell, you know. Whereas, you know, other cultures, you know, they enjoy the day. And all the security is, you know, just slowing down the enjoyment of the day. So obviously, you know, this is a really subjective thing, security, and, you know, it doesn't fit, you know, the same solutions don't fit for every society. So,
You know, as a New Yorker, it's an article of faith that crime dropped in my city because of changes in policing. There's absolutely no evidence whatsoever that actually supports this statement. And if one looks at a set of economic and demographic changes, you've actually got much better explanations for how people, you know, since really spontaneously recreated order in their own town, in their own space. So I'm just incredibly skeptical of the claim that, you know, it's the punitive threat from the other that makes me behave. I just actually don't necessarily buy that. I think maybe it's the other way around, that I know from my own experience, as David Hume would say, you know, 'tis plain. That by acting it with a certain comportment, that things work really well for me. And it seems to me that most people seem to figure that out. You know, if I act most of the time in a certain direct, trustable, trustworthy kind of way, then things usually go well for me. And it's often, in fact, people for whom that path is blocked then end up in these other kind of strategies altogether. And one cannot discount the factor of race in a city of New York, is, well, why would you turn to crime? Well, there's nothing else you can damn well turn to because all the other doors are closed. But if you open them, maybe then people, you know, gather through their own experience that there are much, much more useful ways of acting. So I just don't see the kind of threat of the other as being anything but a kind of secondary and peripheral guide to behavior.
Well, but it's a matter of fact that, for example, this building in its first inauguration wouldn't exist if there, for example, hadn't been the Berlin airlift during the Cold War. So I think that the issue is not so simple to dismiss as simply an ideological point. But in the statement itself, I see this kind of differentiation, namely that you say yourself, I'm a German, so I have this concept of security, and maybe other people have others. It obviously means that even if we disagree on these matters, we have different concepts of security, and that there is no such thing as a base concept of security. And then if we have now talked about freedom as a kind of counter concept to security, then maybe we have to put the same question mark behind it as to security. I mean, it seems to be an easy temptation to speak of freedom instead of security, but on more or less the same conceptual philosophical dispositive that also created this chimera of security as a closed, unique, one cultural, basic term. So basic freedom maybe also doesn't exist in that way. I don't know.
I mean, there is another German tradition. I'm not a specialist in it, but Hölderlin, for me, just immediately seems to be speaking of something else in another way. I think there are many, many strands of German culture. I wouldn't want to collapse it down to that point at all.
But still, I mean, then we, I think, get to an even more complicated part of the discussion, namely the basics. I think this is now the next step we have to take. Does it really make sense to speak of basics? And isn't that... If we can so easily break down or get into unresolvable conflicts, if we just talking about one aspect of that, like freedom and security, isn't the whole presupposition of basics in itself something that is problematic?
You know, I took it in the sense of like base and superstructure. This much maligned, you know, it's usually like the vulgar Marxist argument is the one that insists on base and superstructure, but I actually find it incredibly helpful to actually think about what are the things that are basic in terms of what drives historical change. And it seems to me there's something to be said for a kind of political economic diagram of what those forces are. It won't tell you everything. It's not an iron law of history or any such thing, but it's a useful method for trying to figure out how the world is put together.
I don't know. I see a certain kind of exhaustion here in the audience, and people
getting
out.
Right,
it seems that by sort of tearing apart all these basics, we're losing the basics in the audience as well. So we have a performative aspect to our discussion as well. So if there are no basics in our community right now, maybe we should wrap it up at this point.
Time for a drink, I think.
For a drink, but we can argue about freedom.
Yeah. I'm Australian. Sunday's the time to have a drink. I mean, simple as that. But thank you. Okay. Thank you all. Didn't find natural selection. Not enough. It's still up.
It is. Actually, Graham just got it back up again.
Howard? Graham Howard?
No, yes.